بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So in the last class I had begun the discussion of the Dajjal, and I had mentioned some of the ahadith about the creation or the characteristics of the Dajjal. And again, to go over some of them and to reiterate, the concept of Dajjal has been narrated by over 40 companions. We have a hadith about Dajjal in every single book of hadith without exception. The six books and Musnad Imam Ahmad and At-Tabarani, and the books go on and on and on. The concept of Dajjal is something that the hadith scholars say is mutawatir. And mutawatir is the highest level of hadith narrations. What it means? Too many people have narrated it. You know, if one person narrates, perhaps some can say his memory, this and that. I mean, perhaps one can say. But when you have 10, 20, 30, 40, in the case of Dajjal, more than 40 Sahaba are narrating from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have more chains than you can count. Then to come and deny the Dajjal, to negate the Dajjal and the existence of the Dajjal, the only way you can do this is if you don't believe in hadith, okay? The only way you can end up rejecting the Dajjal is if you don't believe in hadith. And there are groups that did not believe in hadith and they still don't believe in hadith. And that's a separate topic altogether. The Mu'tazila of old, they rejected hadith. In these days as well, you have your modernist or so-called, you know, progressives or whatnot. They also deny hadith, and that's their strand of Islam. For the majority of the ummah, especially those that ascribe to what is called Sunni Islam, as I say over and over again, the definition of Sunni Islam is to respect the Sunnah. That's why Sunni is called Sunni, from the Sunnah. We believe in the Sunnah as the second source of law after the Quran. There are groups that don't believe in the Sunnah, that's their business, and that's a different topic altogether. For those who accept the Sunnah, and I am one of them, you cannot accept the Sunnah and negate the Dajjal. Is that clear? It doesn't come hand in hand. Too many ahadith about the Dajjal. And as I said, they are every level. Sahih, mutawatir, authentic. And of course, there are some weak hadith about the Dajjal as well. But the concept is mutawatir. And we don't have time to go over all 45 narrations or 45 actual sahaba. There are more than 45 narrations. 45 companions narrated a hadith about the Dajjal. It will take us a number of dissertations to go over all of them. In a nutshell, what are some of the characteristics of the Dajjal? Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that Dajjal shall be physically deformed. Multiple ahadith about him not being even up to the standards of a regular, you know, a normal human being. And a number of things are mentioned about him. Most prominently, the fact that one or both of his eyes is deformed. Our scholars have differed, is it right or left? But in all likelihood, it's really one eye. And so one eye will be festered. One eye will be basically like a floating grape or a festered grape, as our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. Of the ahadith as well about the descriptions of the Dajjal, as we said, is that anybody who has an ounce of iman will recognize the Dajjal because they shall see the word kafir written on his forehead. And our Prophet ﷺ said, the illiterate person will read it just as well as the literate person. You don't need to be a literate person to even recognize the concept of the Dajjal. Of the things mentioned about the Dajjal, our Prophet ﷺ said, the Dajjal shall have no children. عَقِيمٌ لَا يُولَدُ لَهُ. The Dajjal will not have any children. So the Dajjal will be a person who will come towards the end of times, and of the characteristics, he shall claim to be the Masih, and then he shall claim to be the Rabb himself. So there's going to be a coming bigger and bigger of his claims. He shall claim to be Allah Azza wa Jal himself. He shall claim to be the Rabb. And our Prophet explicitly said this, that he shall claim to be the Rabb, and know that you shall not see your Rabb in this world. So the concept of seeing Allah is valid, but not in this dunya. So he linked the concept of seeing Allah with Dajjal. He said, know that you shall not see your Lord in this world, because you will see him when? On Judgment Day and in Jannah. You will see him in the Akhirah, inshaAllah ta'ala. May Allah make us amongst them. So he said, you will not see your Lord in this world. Meaning, anybody who claims to be God is lying. Nobody that you will see will be God in this world. And he also mentioned that I will tell you that the Dajjal is one-eyed and your Lord is not one-eyed. What does it mean, your Lord is not one-eyed? It means that Dajjal will not even be a perfect human being. How can he be God? Even his imperfection is obvious. He doesn't even have two eyes. Your Lord is not imperfect. Your Lord Azza wa Jal is Jalla Jalalu. He is perfect. You will see Dajjal. You will recognize him. He's not even, he has the regular capabilities of a human. How then can he claim to be God? And Allah Azza wa Jal will not be seen in this world. And Allah Azza wa Jal is Laysa bi'a'war. He is not one eye. Of the things that are mentioned as well about the Dajjal is that he shall walk with crooked legs. His legs will be basically not straight legs. So another deformity, that he will not be walking normally. All of these are meant to emphasize as well that the Dajjal is a person who has physical imperfections, and yet in his arrogance he is claiming to be God himself, to be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one hadith in Tirmidhi, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the Dajjal will come from an eastern land that is called Khurasan. The Dajjal will come from an eastern land that is called Khurasan. And groups of people will follow him. They will be as if their faces are hammered out shields. So a shield that has been hammered out, i.e. a flat face. Now, some have said these are the description of the Eastern folk, and Allah knows best. But the point is, their facial features will be something that is atypical for the Arab race. So for the Arabs, they will not find them to be of their race. The majority of people that will follow him will be from that other race. As well, our Prophet ﷺ said, and the hadith is in Musnad Imam Ahmad, and it is a Hasan hadith, that the Dajjal will come from a city called Isfahan. So it is mentioned by name. The Dajjal will come from a city called Isfahan, from the Yahud of the city of Isfahan, and many of his followers will be from that city. 70,000 of the Yahud of Isfahan will be his followers. And therefore, we see from this that the Dajjal, his background will be from the Bani Israel. And many of his followers will be from the Bani Israel. And in another hadith it is mentioned that he shall come between the lands of Iraq and Sham. So how do we reconcile he shall come from Isfahan and he shall come between Iraq and Sham? And our scholars have said that he will first appear, his first claim will be in Isfahan. But he will get global attention between Iraq and Sham. So there's going to be levels of his appearing outward. There's going to be levels of claiming. And his first claim will be in Isfahan. In the land of Iran is Isfahan. And of course Isfahan, by the way, interesting footnote here, that from the first temple's destruction of Babylon, the first batch of the diaspora of the Bani Israel, they migrated to Isfahan. And to this day there is a group from that religion in the people of Isfahan. To this day, from the first destruction of the temple, from the days of Nebuchadnezzar, these are the Yehud of the diaspora, and they are still a small group. They used to be much more in number before 1947, but of course because of the creation of the country, and many of them migrated to that land. So in all Arab and Muslim lands they become very small, but there is still a synagogue in that city, and there are still people of that faith tradition in that city. And our Prophet ﷺ said that the Dajjal will come from that particular land and that particular city and that particular race and religion, and he will be from that people. Also, we learn in the authentic hadith that the Dajjal will come at a time of great chaos, bloodshed, hunger, starvation, and he will provide his followers safety and security. This explains why so many people will follow the Dajjal. You see, Alhamdulillah, most of us have never been hungry to the point of us going almost mad. We don't understand. When you are hungry, you lose rationale. When you cannot feed yourself or your children, you will do desperate things. May Allah protect us from ever seeing that day. The people of that time frame will be tested by trial, war, bloodshed, hunger, starvation. Here comes a man who appears to be powerful in terms of his army, who will grant you safety and security if you are on his side. Our Prophet ﷺ said, he will command the skies to rain and they will rain. Our Prophet ﷺ said, he will distribute bread and food. One of his signs, he will be giving food left, right, and center at a time of starvation. When people are starving, they're willing to do many things. He will demand his followers believe in him first as the Messiah, and many of them will. When they believe in him as the Messiah, he will then up the notch. He will then raise the bar, or we should say lower the bar. And he will say, I am your God. I provide your food for you. I provide your drink for you. I give you safety and security. And so his followers will then take him as a God. And he will at that time frame give his followers food and drink, and many other people will not have that food and drink, and so people will begin to follow him en masse. And this is the fitna of the issue of the Dajjal. As well, our Prophet ﷺ said that he will have the shayateen at his disposal. He will have the shayateen at his disposal. So the shayateen will do things at his command. And the shayateen are able to do what we are not able to do. The shayateen do not have supernatural powers. They have superhuman powers. The two are different. Supernatural is not the same as superhuman. A horse has superhuman powers. It's faster than us. It doesn't make it supernatural. Okay? An elephant has superhuman. It's stronger than us. It's not supernatural. Jinns have powers that Allah has given them. Once we understand their powers, there's nothing strange about them. Nothing strange. It's just that the only thing that we should understand is that they're in a world that we cannot see. إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ He, Shaytan, sees you from a dimension you cannot see him. The jinn are faster than us, stronger than us, and they're invisible. That's it. Faster and stronger, many creatures are faster and stronger. We're not scared per se of supernaturally scared, even of lions. We're not scared supernaturally. We might be scared a natural fear, but we're not terrified in the sense of supernatural. The only thing that freaks us out is that jinn are in the world of the unseen. Otherwise, if we understand that the jinn are faster and stronger, what they can do is they can lift more than a human can lift. But they're not supernatural. They cannot lift the whole world and all that is in it. They can lift maybe what five people can lift up, like the story of Sulaiman and carrying the throne. They're faster than us. They can go faster at the speed of light. Other than that, they are natural creations of Allah. So these entities will declare their loyalty to the Dajjal. Once they declare their loyalty to the Dajjal, they will willingly cooperate with the Dajjal. And the Dajjal will appear to be a very powerful, supernatural person. In reality, he simply has some of the tricks and trades of the jinn. The jinn will make illusions, the jinn will lift things up, the jinn will, and the people will not see the jinn. The Dajjal will say, do this, and something will happen, and the people will assume that it is the power of the Dajjal. It is also possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test the people by giving the Dajjal one or two issues that others do not have. Just like Allah has given Shaytan himself a blessing. Shaytan has been given some life, and what do you want to call it? Something that we have not been given. And that is a long life, right? Did not Allah give Shaytan something that we do not have? And that is life until Judgment Day. No other person has that. No other person. No human being has that. And Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to Shaytan as a test for Shaytan and as a test for us as well. So it is possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give Dajjal certain privileges and powers that are a test to him and are a test to those who follow him, and will be a sign of iman for those who reject him. And of them is the power and the capability to cause the sky to rain, because jinns don't have that power. Jinns cannot cause the skies to rain. Only Allah can do that, right? as Allah says in the Quran, who is the one who sends the matar from the heavens? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah can give that power. As well, He will have the power to at least once, maybe more, but the minimum is once, He will have the power to resurrect the dead. And that is another thing that He resembles with the true Masih, and that is Isa ibn Maryam. That's why He is the false Masih. There are certain things in common, but Isa ibn Maryam said, worship Allah, and Dajjal says, worship me. That's why he is Dajjal. So, for sure, he will resurrect one person at least from the dead. But in all likelihood, he will pretend to resurrect other people from the dead. This is explicit. It is mentioned in Sahih Muslim that a person will come and not believe in Dajjal. And he will be a person who doesn't know Quran, Sunnah. He is a Muslim, he doesn't know much. Dajjal will say, what if I resurrect your parents in front of your eyes? And what if I tell, or your parents tell you to believe in me? Will you believe in me? So he says, of course, if my parents come and say, hey, then I'll believe. So he will command the shayateen to take on the forms of the parents of this person. You see, shayateen can come in forms. You know, this culture believes in ghosts. Whenever we get to the issue of jinn and whatnot, we will say, there's no such thing as ghosts wandering this world. The ruh does not remain, the ruh goes. But what can happen is the jinn can take on the form of a person. So that when you see that entity, you think it is that person who has died, but it is not that person who has died. The person who has died is gone, that's it, they're not going to come back. But the jinn can take on the shape of that person. So the Dajjal will tell two jinns to come in the form of the parents of that person. And the person will then see his own mother and father. He will think they are in the flesh. They are not in the flesh, they are jinn. And his mother and father will say, oh my son, this is your Lord, worship Him. This is true, worship Him. So the man, naive, innocent, he go, okay, my mother and father say so, he can, you know, my Dajjal, he will think it's God Himself, can resurrect the dead, then I will believe in Him. So the Prophet ﷺ warned us that he will have tricks and trades. He also said he will have with him Jannah and Nar. Some have said it literally means a fire and a garden. Some have said it means he will come with what appears to be blessings and lots of punishment. Both are allowed here because Jannah represents money and fruits and, you know, sustenance, and Nar represents punishments and torture. So it could be that he actually has a physical Jannah and Nar, and it could be that what the Prophet is saying, because the Arabic allows this, and we're going to come to this issue, when is it metaphorical, when is it literal? You know, Jannah can indicate luscious gardens. It can indicate lots of fruits and pleasures. So he will have with him pleasures, and he will have with him punishments and tortures. So our Prophet ﷺ said, realize his pleasures are actually his torture. And what you think are his tortures are actually Jannah. So if one of you sees it and cannot escape, the Prophet ﷺ said, he should jump into the punishments, and that will save him. So if you have real iman in Allah, when you see Dajjal and he has his torture mechanism, he has entities that you think will harm you, will kill you, the Prophet ﷺ said, jump into what you think is harmful and you will be safe. Now, it is possible, and Allah knows best, it is possible that these nar that you see are the shayateen. And when you jump into them, you are demonstrating, what are you demonstrating? Iman. You are demonstrating iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only way to fight the shayateen, you cannot fight them with your fists, can you? They're stronger than you. You cannot take them down with your physical strength. The one thing that you have that will diminish the shayateen is your iman in Allah. Our Prophet ﷺ, hadith is in Abu Dawud. He was on an expedition and a certain person's camel went upward and almost threw the person off for no reason. In the middle of the desert, the camel just goes up. So the man or the woman said, may Allah curse shaitan. Shaitan caused my camel to do this. The Prophet ﷺ said, Do not mention shaitan like that. Because if you do, his ego will become so big, he will become bigger than a house. Because you ascribed this to shaitan. Rather say, Bismillah. And when you do so, shaitan will become smaller than an atom. What was the power that was used? The name of Allah. The name of Allah, Iman, caused the shaitan to become insignificant. It is possible, it's not too much of a stretch, to say that the Dajjal will have instruments of protection, looks like protection and food and drinks, and instruments of torture and evil and whatnot. When the people see, they will be terrified and they will rush to the gardens, thinking that that's going to save them and that's going to destroy them in the Akhirah. Our Prophet ﷺ said, if you have no choice, you have between the garden and the fire, jump into the fire of the Dajjal. It is very possible, it's not a stretch, that this, as we said, torture of Dajjal might actually be physical. Could be armies of evil people and you know, whatever, jinn, shayateen. And if you jump into it, putting your trust in Allah, you will go unharmed. Everybody will run away and you will be safe because your iman in Allah will save you. So this is the test of iman when you see the actual Dajjal. Also, our Prophet ﷺ described the Dajjal as being ahmar. And ahmar means what? Oh, Arabs, what does ahmar mean? Red. Do you think he will be red, red? Dajjal will be red? Brownish? You made him a desi? No, no, no. We just said, where is he from? He's not a desi, don't worry. What is red? The Arabs of old, they would call what we call in modern vernacular Caucasian, they would call them reddish or yellowish. Ahmar or asfar was the term the Arabs used to describe the Caucasian types of people. Okay? The term white was not, yani generally abiyad wasn't used to describe skin color. Okay? Ahmar, because yani what happens when they go in the sun, you know, yani the tan and whatnot, you know, they become ahmar, literally, like, you know, yellow and whatnot. Even this native Indians, what they call them, yellow face, pale face, this is their term for them, not my term, is their term. So the notion of them being yellowish or reddish, right? So when the hadith mentions any nation or race as being yellow or red, this is our equivalent of that complexion, okay? So he did, the Prophet ﷺ described him as being ahmar. And ahmar means basically of that race. And again, it fits into the description of the ethnicity of the Dajjal. As well, the Prophet ﷺ said that his hair will be curly. Ja'd. Ja'd is curly hair. His hair will be curly. He also described him as being relatively short. He also described him as being broad-chested. He also described him, as we said, as having legs that are not straight. So he's not walking in a straight gait. He has basically deformed legs. So these are all descriptions that are given of the Dajjal. And he also mentioned in Hadith in Musnad Imam Ahmed that the majority of people who follow Dajjal will be from the Yahud, and also he said from the women. Now why will the women follow the Dajjal? Because of the safety given. At that time there will be chaos, at that time there will be hunger and starvation, and so those who choose to follow the Dajjal, they will have that safety. And so it is possible that in that time frame, in that chaos and whatnot, people, certain types of people will be attracted to the false promises of safety that the Dajjal gives. As well, as we had mentioned, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that the Dajjal will come, that the Dajjal will come, will appear between Iraq and Sham, and he will go through every single city in the world. He will go through every single city in the world. Now, I've already mentioned last class that every city, kullu in Arabic, does not mean each and every without exception. This is not the meaning of kullu in Arabic. Kullu in Arabic can and typically does mean the majority. This is what typically the word kullu means. And unfortunately in English, most of the translators, when they translate kullu, they translate it as each and every. Yani the point is that the majority of cities and the large cities in the world, the Dajjal will go through all of those cities, except of course for which city? Mecca and Medina. And we learn from the ahadith that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he shall try to enter Mecca and Medina. He shall try to enter Mecca and Medina, and he shall be stopped at the gates of Mecca and Medina by the angels. So if you want to be safe from the Dajjal, one of the things that you can do is to flee to Mecca and Medina during that time frame. During that time frame. As well, in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Dajjal will try to enter Medina and he shall be prevented from doing so, and then he shall cause the city of Medina to tremble 3 times is an earthquake. So the jinn, the shayateen, will stamp on the city and there will be the notion of the earthquake. So people will think this is the destruction of Medina, that Dajjal is causing the destruction of Medina. So our Prophet ﷺ said that the munafiqoon will all flee Medina and Medina will be left pure with believers. Who will remain in Medina? Those who believe in the hadith. Those who believe in hadith, do you understand where I'm coming from? It's prediction. When Medina will start shaking and there's a man outside the door claiming to be God, you have already been warned by the Prophet ﷺ, stay in Medina. So the only people that will remain in Medina will be the ones who believe in the Prophet ﷺ and not in Dajjal. So our Prophet ﷺ said, Medina is like a furnace. It separates the chaff from the purity. It separates the abnormalities or it filters the filth from the pure, like the furnace does. The furnace purifies, you know, the mineral ore comes out, purifies. Medina is like a furnace. And he said this hadith in the context of Dajjal. So Dajjal will filter through Medina. And therefore, this also explains, when I talked about the Mahdi 3 or 4 weeks ago, why will many of his followers, the Mahdi, why will his followers be from Medina? Because Medina will be 100% pure. 100% pure. So who's going to go and fight on the side of the Mahdi and on the side of Isa? The people of Medina will stay there, and they will then go out when the Mahdi comes. That is when the people of Medina will exit and they will fight under the banner of the Mahdi. And the Mahdi, of course, will be fighting the Dajjal, as I already mentioned when we talked about the Mahdi. So the Dajjal will come to Mecca and Medina, but will be prevented from entering. And wherever he goes, he will gather more and more followers, and he will gain a very, very large army. Now, we also learn that the Dajjal will go to Medina. This is a very interesting hadith, and I actually looked this up when I first read it. I couldn't believe it was that explicit. I actually went back to Muslim Imam Ahmad and looked at it, but this hadith is in Muslim Imam Ahmad. And it says that the Dajjal will go to one of the mountains outside Medina after he has been denied entry by the angels. And he will take his followers to one of the mountains outside of the Haram's boundary. Outside of the Haram's boundary. Folklore and superstition says that it is the mountain where one of the major palaces is, but Allah knows best. That's folklore and superstition, which might not be far from the truth given all that's happening right now. But anyway, so the Dajjal will take his followers to that mountain, and the hadith says he shall point to the masjid and he shall say, do you see that white house? Al-Bayt Al-Abyad, the white house, not the White House here in DC. Do you see that white house? That is the house and the masjid of Ahmed. And he will call him Ahmed, not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why is this so interesting? Because if you ever fly into Medina, if you look down from the airplane, you will see a massive white complex. Because it's all marble. And you can see it for many, many miles. And you can see it from the mountaintops. You can see it from the plane. I have had the pleasure of flying into Medina many, many times. And it is truly beautiful. It's beautiful because this is a very massive complex, as you know, and it is white. And you can see it from far away. And the hadith explicitly mentions that he will see in the distance, he will point to a complex, and he will call it the white masjid and the white house. And he will say the house is white, meaning, right? That white house is the house of Ahmed, the masjid of Ahmed. And it is something that, you know, Allah knows best, the very structure that we have. Allah knows best, because it is a very sturdy structure. It will last Allah knows how many hundreds of years, or we hope that Dajjal will not come in our lifetime, inshallah. So we hope it'll last many hundreds of years, and it might be that very structure, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Now we also learn from, and this is not explicit, but it's inferred from the hadith of the Mahdi. It is inferred from the hadith of the Mahdi that the forces of Dajjal and the Muslims will be fighting multiple battles. And the Muslims will be able to protect themselves partially, but they'll never be able to destroy the army of Dajjal. This is a very, very key point. The Dajjal will not be victorious in every battle, but he will be protected as a person. He will not be harmed by, or at least killed, Allah knows if he's going to be harmed, by anybody other than obviously who? Isa ibn Maryam. Okay, and we're going to talk about Isa, but maybe in the next lesson or whatnot, the coming of Isa and the signs of that. So the Dajjal and his army will fight multiple fights, not just one. And maybe, Allah knows best, and again, all of this is surmising, it's not even going to be one army in one location. Rather, there will be the forces. Which side are you on? Are you on the side of Dajjal or on the side of the truth? So the world will be divided into two camps. Not necessarily one physical army, but two camps, two entities. You are fighting for the Dajjal, or you're fighting for the truth and righteousness and taqwa and Allah and His Messenger. And it is possible that some of the battles and the skirmishes, the Muslims will be victorious, and some they will not be victorious. And we know this because of the hadith of the Mahdi. Because the Prophet ﷺ is saying that they're fighting the army here, they're fighting the army there, until finally they will hear the cry that Dajjal has come out and he's attacking your family. So they're going to go back in fear that they're going to see the Dajjal, and they will find out that it is a false cry. Which means during that time frame, people will begin to recognize this is the end of times. And the smallest rumor will provoke theories of Dajjal. And there will come a time frame where they're just waiting, when is the Dajjal, when is the Dajjal? And it will indeed happen that the Muslim army with the Mahdi is fighting somewhere, we don't know where. And the news, the rumors will come, Dajjal has come where you left. Wherever you were, Dajjal is now where your families were. So they're going to rush back towards Sham. That's where they're going to be based, Bilad al-Sham. They're going to rush back to Sham, only to discover that the Dajjal has not yet come. Then the Dajjal will come. And we don't know how long between this news of the Dajjal coming, but eventually then the Mahdi will be leading them in Damascus, as we already mentioned, in Salat al-Fajr, and Isa will then come down. Okay, so all of this will happen in the time of the Mahdi, the fighting of the Dajjal. This also means, and again, Allah knows best, all of this is kind of sort of deriving, and it's very terrifying in light of what is happening right now. And this is an interpretation, that the forces of good and the forces of evil will begin to demarcate before the coming of the Dajjal and before the coming of the Mahdi. Because there's already wars going on and there is no Dajjal. There's already fighting taking place and Dajjal has not yet come. But the situation is being prepared for the coming of Dajjal. So it appears that there will be skirmishes, major wars, bloodshed. In some ahadith it is mentioned out of 199 will die. So what happiness will the survivor have? When will that happen? With Dajjal or before Dajjal? We do not know. We do not know. There is going to be a massive war. The Prophet ﷺ said that the bird that is flying above will fall down dead. Is this nuclear war? Something like this? Again, these are all ahadith that it's not too far-fetched to read in nuclear war. right? As Einstein famously remarked, I don't know what World War III will be fought with, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones. It's a very profound statement. I don't know what World War III is going to be fought with, but whatever it is fought with, that's it. That will be the end of civilization. Because too much nuclear powers, too much whatnot. World War IV, if there ever is one, will be with sticks and stones. And by the way, this also goes to another issue. These are hadith about horses in the time of Dajjal. These are hadith about swords and whatnot. Do we take them literally? Allah knows. Both opinions are valid. And it is permissible to call a weapon a sword. And maybe there are some fancy weapons and whatnot. And it is also not unfeasible, not unrealistic to assume that towards the end of times, all technology as we know it will be gone. And the only way that we can imagine this to happen is a real and true Armageddon. You know, there is this genre of movies. Not that I'm encouraging you to watch movies, I'm just telling you this is the reality. There's this genre of movies that, you know, the apocalypse happening, or what's going to happen after the nuclear explosion. And in almost all of them, what do we see? Common sense, logic dictates that when this whole world goes to war next time, may Allah protect us, and nuclear weapons are used everywhere, what is going to happen to civilization? It's gone. We're going to be back to sticks and stones. We're going to be back to lighting fires with not even matches, but rubbing things together. Like, we're going to go back to that time frame. So it is not inconceivable at all to interpret these ahadith literally, that the Dajjal and his followers and the Muslims and the Mahdi will literally be fighting on horses and swords and whatnot, because all of that will be gone. Or to be metaphorical is also possible. All of this is, and it's not too much of a stretch as well, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So these are some ahadith about the Dajjal, and obviously the issue of Dajjal coming towards the end of times. Our Prophet said he shall live 40 amongst you. That famous hadith, he shall live 40 amongst you. How much 40? He said one of them will be like a year, one of them will be like a month, one of them will be like a week, and the rest will be like your regular days. Okay? The rest will be like your regular days. So you can calculate what is this going to be. 1 year plus 1 month plus 1 week plus all of the rest of them will be regular days. Now, what does this mean? Again, remember, the ahadith of the end of times are cryptic. Always. The slave shall give birth to her master. What does it mean? Barefoot, naked shepherds are going to compete with tall buildings. Is it literally barefoot and naked, or their ancestors were barefoot and shepherds? Because as we said, these princes, they are not barefoot and shepherds anymore, but their grandfathers were. Again, a little bit of crypticism. Allah knows best. So what does it mean, the first day will be like a year? Does it mean that it will actually be 1 year? And so the time frame of Dajjal will be 1 year, 1 month, 1 week, and 37 days? Or does it mean that time will appear to go slow? Nuclear weapons, Armageddon, Allahu A'lam. Does it mean that everything will just appear like that for a long time frame? Allahu A'lam. The famous hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, and this shows us the status of Salah. When we hear these ahadith, our minds goes here and there. So when the Sahaba heard it, the first thing they said, Ya Rasulullah, how do we pray in that year that is a day? Yani they are so much into Salah, right, that the first thing their minds ask is, how do we pray in that year that's going to be a day, or that day that's going to be a year? And our Prophet ﷺ said, you estimate it. You estimate it. So uninterpretation, and this is all ijtihad, uninterpretation is that there will be no sunlight for a year. So it will appear that for one full year it is as if it's a day and night. And that's why our Prophet said, you keep on estimating the times of Salah. You keep on estimating the times of Salah, even if you don't see the sun and the moon. This is uninterpretation. And the only way that there will be no sunlight all over the world is, once again, if these weapons of mass destruction. The irony is the very country that claimed others have weapons of mass destruction is itself guilty of having the worst weapons of mass destruction. And as it accused others falsely and invaded others falsely, this is a complete tangent as you can see, as it accused others falsely and invaded others falsely, it is the only country in human history that has used the nuclear weapon against innocent civilians in the cities of, which ones? Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The irony of ironies. They get to accuse everybody as they go scot-free themselves. And this is the way of the Jabbar and the Mutakabbir. Anyway, so the point being, where was I? Talking about the one day. Allah knows best. A very valid interpretation, which I don't see to be unreasonable, that year will be an actual year. It will be an actual year. 365 days, but people will not be able to recognize them as day and night. And then slowly but surely the smog will settle, whatnot, and so the next one will be like a month, that okay, things are clearing up, and then whatever might happen. So Allah knows best. This could be an interpretation where we can reconcile. Or time can go slow. I mean, Allah ala kulli shayin qadir, and there's nothing yani either way that we can do this. But we learn from this that the Dajjal will be on this earth for a period of time that is reasonable. It's not that much of a stretch. Even if we say 40 days, the first one of which is a year, and then a month. So in total, it's less than 2 years. Right? In total, it's less than 2 years. A year and a few months, right? 2 months and something. That's not too long, alhamdulillah. Now, the Dajjal will be here, meaning he shall be Dajjal for that time frame. He will grow up, as we said, a regular child. He might not even know he's the Dajjal when he's growing up, or maybe he will, we don't know. One of the two. As the hadith mentions, he shall appear when someone provokes him, which means in Isfahan, something's going to happen, and he's just going to go berserk and ballistic, and then realize he has these powers or jinns or shayateen that others don't have, and then take it from there, take advantage of that, and go from bad to worse, declare himself the Masih, get his followers, eventually go ahead and declare himself God himself, and all of this is going to grow worse and worse and worse. So all of these are the hadith of the Dajjal. Now, our Prophet ﷺ said, hadith is in Musnad Imam Ahmad, that most of his followers will be from the Yahud. Now, this leads us to a very interesting issue and tangent. We had mentioned last class, last week, that the Christian belief is very similar to our belief, especially the evangelicals, that Jesus is the Masih, and he shall come back towards the end of times, that there shall be a false Messiah, the Antichrist, and that Christ and Antichrist will fight it out, and that Christ will win over the Antichrist in the great Armageddon. In this rough skeleton, we are the same. No issues. Now, with the devil's in the detail, and they have a lot of other ikhtilafat, but in this skeleton, evangelicals, Baptists, Muslims, we all believe the same thing. Of course, there are many differences of them. We do not have this as an explicit mention, but they do. And that is that this will only happen when the Bani Israel are gathered in the Holy Land. Okay, this is the belief of evangelicals, that Jesus will only come back when all of the Bani Israel are gathered in the Holy Land. And therefore, because they want to see their Lord and Savior, they are eager to bring the Bani Israel to the Holy Land. Are you guys following? I'm being وَاللَّبِيبُ بِالْإِشَارَةِ يَفْهَمُ I'm being... So they want the people of that faith tradition to go to that land. And it is because of this that some of the most hardcore Zionists are not people of the Jewish faith. They are evangelicals. Because it is their aqidah. It is their aqidah that with the return of the promised people to the promised land, their Savior will come back. So they want to expedite that. Now, ironically, they believe when the Savior comes, one of the first things he's going to do is to get rid of those who didn't believe in him. And primarily, according to their aqidah, the people who tried to kill him. Or actually succeeded in killing, because they believe they succeeded. Now, this is the irony of ironies. Think about it. I need you to understand my point here. This group wants to expedite and support the Bani Israel to go to this land with the aqeedah that they will all be destroyed in that land. You understand this? They are ardent Zionists, and they have no love for the people whom they are helping. On the contrary, their aqeedah is that the very people they're helping, you understand this point, right? Wallahi, ajab al-ujab, ajib. How can the other group accept their aid knowing that this group wants us dead? And you know, my mind was perplexed, and I actually, you know, I am interfaith person, I'm involved in whatnot. I had a friendship with one of the rabbis of Memphis, and we would go out to lunch every, you know, few weeks and whatnot. It's good to have interfaith and friendship, and we got to a very frank point. So I actually asked him, I said, aren't you embarrassed to accept help from people who think that helping you will eventually cause you to be killed? Yani, isn't there some haya sharam, some dignity, some izzah? Like, the very people who want to get rid of you, they're helping you in the aqeedah that you will be gotten rid of. And he just smirked. He goes, well, that's their belief. If they want to throw money and power at us, then, you know, we don't believe it's going to happen. Basically, he said in a nutshell, if they're foolish enough to believe it, that's their business. We're going to still accept their power and help. So we have to understand this point, O Muslims. The people who are supporting this guy in the White House, right? This whole move to Jerusalem, the capital, whatnot. This is all a tactical decision. He might be a blabbering idiot, but he is a tactical blabbering idiot. He knows what he's doing. He is feeding his base. Another tangent here, subhanAllah. He is feeding his base. He's giving them the scraps from the table. Why is he doing this? He knows his base is evangelical. He knows this people, they want him. And so they feed him this stuff to do what? Because they want this land to be the promised land for the promised people, so that the Messiah comes and gets rid of these very people to establish heaven on earth and whatnot, and the final judgment day, all of this is going to happen. So this is the aqidah of the evangelicals. By the way, Catholics are different. Please, Muslims, educate yourselves. Don't be kindergarten level in your education and just extrapolate. Every Christian group is different. Every firqa is different. Learn your firq if you want to get involved in this issue. Otherwise, do not speak. Speak with knowledge or remain silent. Various groups have different aqidahs. The Mormons are different. They have their own beliefs. The Seventh-day Adventists are totally different in this regard. And of course, the evangelicals, which is of course the default in the state, the Baptists and whatnot, these are the ones that we're talking about now. And their aqidah is in some ways very similar to ours, in some ways it's different. So that's the Yahud. That's the Christians. How about the Yahud? What is their belief in the Messiah? And why is our Prophet ﷺ saying that the majority of the followers of Dajjal will be from that group? Well, in Jewish eschatology, the term Mashiach, it refers specifically, they do have this aqidah, and it refers to a future king from the line of David. Okay? So, mainstream Jewish belief is that there will be a person from the line of David, from the descendants of Dawood, who will be a king, and he will be anointed, Masih. He will be anointed with holy oil, and he will bring in the messianic age. He will bring in the end of times. So, the Masih in their aqidah is called the King Masih, Malach Mashiach, Malak. Malach Mashiach, the King Masih. Because for them, the Masih is a political figure, not a religious reformer. Okay? For them, it was the Masih is a one of power and politics, and not somebody who comes tazkiyatun nafs, and you know, Isa is coming and telling them, you know, ubashirukum, and giving you glad tidings. The, you know, the bushra is the evangelion, or the evangelical, the injil. Injil, evangelical, by the way, evangelical and injil, the same term. Injil is injil, the good tidings. The evangelical, that's where it comes from. So the Messiah in Jewish folklore is a king from the line of Dawood, who will bring about the restoration of the status of the Israelites and reconstruct the temple of Israel. Okay? So they do believe in the Masih as a political figure and who will bring back the kingdom of who? Of Dawood. And this has been a mainstream of ancient, medieval, and even some modern Jewish movements, as we're going to come to right now. And that is why, dear Muslims, when the Masih Isa came and he began preaching to the Bani Israel and he claimed he was the Masih, the Yahud did not care about a Masih that's a spiritual reformer. They wanted a Masih who is what? Who is a king. And so when they found out that this person is not a king, they went and complained to the king, to the Roman emperor, and they said, "We have a man who is claiming to be the king of the Israelites." Did Isa claim to be king? Hello, did Isa claim to be king? Why did the Yahud say he's claiming to be king? Are you guys following this? Because he claimed to be the Masih. And in the eyes of the Yahud, the Masih is who? The king. And so, what happened with Pontius Pilate, what happened with them happened, and they said, oh, this is a political agitator. They would not have cared if Jesus said he is a religious reformer. They didn't care. What is there to do with them, a religious reformer? But they did worry that he's claiming to be a king. They don't want any political trouble. And that's why what happened happened. And so they then went to arrest him. And then what happened, we will talk maybe in another lecture. What do we Muslims believe and what are the various theories out there? But anyway, now you understand that issue. Now, the issue we need to come back to is that belief in the advent of the Masih was a mainstream of Jewish theology. And for them, the Masih will bring back the power and the izzah of the kingdom of David that used to be. And therefore, when the single greatest theologian of Jewish law and Jewish theology, there is only one that is Shaykhul Islam amongst them. There is one amongst them in all of their history that they consider to be the greatest Jewish mind. And that is the Jewish theologian, the most famous in the history of Judaism. Anybody? Yes, very good. But who? Oh, Muslims, you should know this name because he was an Arab, meaning he spoke Arabic, that's what I mean. He lived in the lands of Muslims. He spoke Arabic more fluently than any language. He wrote in Arabic, Arabi. And, totally different tangent, why am I going to these tangents? There is a theory that for a period of his life he was a Muslim because he studied in a madrasa, he memorized portions of the Quran, he studied fiqh and aqidah in the Islamic tradition, because back in those days, all universities were run by Muslims. Back in those days, you know, if you go to university here, right, you go to UTD or SMU or something, they tell you, you must take American history, you must take political science, these are the required courses, right? You cannot graduate in this country without taking these courses, right? Well, once upon a time, if you wanted to go to any university and study engineering or medicine or optics, you would have to study Fiqh 101, basics of Sharia. Okay, you'd have to study Tafsir of the Quran. I'm not joking. This is exactly what needed to be done. Okay, that was the. So, Musa ibn Maimonides, you should know the name. Maimonides, memorize this name. This is the single greatest intellectual of Jewish history, completely. They call him the chief rabbi, Rambam. Rambam, the chief rabbi. He was the greatest rabbi in the history of Judaism. He codified Jewish law. The Jewish law that he codified is basically after he studied Islamic Sharia. Now he's writing a book of fiqh. Okay, and he is the first and most important Jewish figure to write a book of aqidah, the book of theology. He wrote a book of theology and he summarized it in 13 points. And he called it the 13 principles of Iman. 13 principles of Iman. Why did he summarize aqidah? Because he studied aqidah from the Muslims and now he wants to do the same for the Jewish faith. And so, Jewish aqidah, when it comes to many things, is actually coming from the philosophy of Ibn Rushd, Averroes, and others, because Musa ibn Maimun, Maimonides, and Averroes were basically coming from the same philosophical strand. Anyway, back to our topic. What am I talking about, guys? What's the topic? What the Yahud believe about what?
About becoming
Dajjal. Exactly. About, no, not about the Dajjal. You're jumping the gun. The Yahud believe about what? Masih. Be careful. The Masih, the Mashiach, the Malach Mashiach, the king of the Messiah. So, Musa ibn Maimun, Maimonides, wrote a book called The 13 Principles of Faith. By the way, you can look it up. It's translated into English. And each principle begins with the phrase, Ani ma'min, ana mu'min, ana mu'min, ana mu'min, ani ma'min in Hebrew. Ana mu'min, this, I believe in this, I believe in this, I believe in this. The 12th principle of these 13, the 12th principle of these 13, and I quote from the translation, my Hebrew is too weak to actually read it to you, I'm not going to embarrass you with that, but I quote from the translation, I believe with full faith, ani ma'min, ana mu'min, in the coming of the Messiah. This is in the Aqidah of Maimonides, which is the standard Aqidah of the Jewish peoples up until our times. He is the only one who has codified to that level, Aqidah and Fiqh. I believe with full faith, yaqeen, certainty, in the coming of the Messiah. And even though he delays, with all that delay, I eagerly await his arrival, every day anticipating his arrival. This is the Aqidah of Maimonides that the Yahud would memorize, that they still believe to this day. And as I have mentioned to you earlier, what time is the adhan? 9:45, right? Still hasn't changed. Okay. As I mentioned to you earlier, we should all be aware that there are three strands, right, of Judaism in our times. They are, number one, which one? Orthodox. Number two, conservative. Number three, reform. There are others, reconstructions, but for ours, let's just keep it these three. And the bulk of them in our times are reform. Okay? Actually, another tangent, but again, this is stuff you should be aware of. This is something interesting. Around 20, 30 years ago, the Orthodox were so minuscule that the assumption was they would disappear. It would be gone, especially in the 70s. But there has been a massive revival. And more Yahud are joining the Orthodox, even if their parents were not Orthodox. And so the Orthodox movement has swelled in ranks. And I don't know the latest statistics, but I think maybe up to 15%, which is a big number compared to what it was in the 70s. 15%, like, you know, one out of eight is an Orthodox, okay? And one of the reasons, by the way, again, all of this is a tangent, but inshallah, it is beneficial to us as Muslims, because we need to learn from the good and the bad. We need to see history. We need to learn what's going on. The fact of the matter is, why is there a return to Orthodoxy? Frankly, because when you have a religion whose values become so watered down that they don't stand for anything, the very people say, what is this? It's not a religion anymore. And they will go back to an actual religion. And this is a big warning to those amongst the Muslim community who are flirting with progressive Islam. When Islam becomes the flavor of the month, then you have no Islam left. Then what is the purpose of being a Muslim? When the halal becomes what is politically correct, and the haram becomes what is politically incorrect, and you have no backbone to stand on, and you think you are preserving your faith, in reality you are losing it. Your children will not have any faith. What do you have left anymore? Our faith is not based upon the whims of society around us. We have the Quran, we have our Sharia, we have the Wahi from Allah. Now I'm not saying we have to be intransigent. No. Our ulama, especially our forward-thinking ulama, have to navigate the flow. Where there's allowance, we will take it. But where there is none, we will not take it. Where there's a red line, we do not go that area. So that's a point we learn. In the 1960s, 70s, there was a massive, as I said, almost everybody is going reform. Their own children began rejecting it. And they said, what is this? There's nothing there. There is no... To be reformed, you can be atheist. You can deny God. There's no Sharia. You can eat pork and whatnot. And there's like, what is left of my Jewishness? They will say, what is left if there's nothing? So there's going back to the asl. And the asl is Orthodox. That is the hardcore literalism. Now, within Orthodox, there are many, many strands. And of course, you have the Hasidic Orthodox. You are all familiar with the Hasidic, H-A-S-I-D-H, the Hasidic. And the Hasidic in particular is a strand of Orthodox. They have a very strong and passionate belief about the coming of the Messiah, that he's very imminent, just about to appear. And they believe, and this is important again, that the more pious they are, the more quickly the Messiah will come. And that explains their fervousness. That explains their ultra, yani, literalism. Right? They want to be, the more pious they are, so the more faithful they are, the faster will come the Messiah. Right? And so they are very, very hardcore about this. And within Hasidism, so this is, I'm teaching you the firq within Orthodox Judaism, okay? By the way, Reform does not believe in the Messiah. It's completely, obviously, right? Reform doesn't believe. Conservatives, mushkila with them is they don't really have la ilaha ula wa la ilaha ula mudabdabin. They don't have, yani, the conservatives, they don't really have a platform per se, because at least with the Orthodox, they're hardcore. Like everything is all the way, right? The Reform, nothing. Throw everything out the window. The conservatives, they don't really have a platform. Some here, some there. How do you decide? Each conservative strand has its own issue. So, amongst the conservatives, some of them believe in the Messiah, some of them don't. Amongst the Orthodox, they all believe in the Messiah. Is that clear? Right? That's why they're still Orthodox. They believe in the coming of the Messiah. The Hasidics are of the most messianic amongst them. And within Hasidism, there is the most prominent stand of Hasidism. It's called the Chabad, C-H-A-B-A-D, the Chabad movement, the Chabad, the Chabad movement. The Chabad movement in particular is the most messianic, so much so, the greatest, one of the greatest Jewish figures of our times, an American born in Russia, migrated after Germany coming here. He died in 1994. His name was Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, one of the most famous rabbis, presidents from, what is it, I forgot who is it, Ford or whatever onwards, they would have regular, he was like America's rabbi of the Orthodox community. Of course, he's passed away in 1994. His followers began to claim that that person is the Messiah. Like, that's how imminent it is. Still to this day, some of his followers believe that the rabbi did not die, that he is still alive in hiding, which sounds similar to other groups, which is why similarities are made between that group and this group, but that is, again, besides this point. So, the point being, where am I heading with all of this? Belief in false Messiah is, not false Messiah, scrap that. Belief in Messiah is common amongst the Yahud. Therefore, do you think it is surprising when towards the end of time, somebody with power comes and claims to be the Messiah, and he is from that background, is it surprising that lots of people will then accept that claim? I need interaction, guys. Huh? It makes sense. You now understand why our Prophet ﷺ said that many of his followers will be of that group. Now, important point. Our Prophet ﷺ did not say many of that group will be his followers. Big difference. It is possible that many of that group, many of the Jews, will recognize truth and falsehood. It is possible. But from those who choose to follow him, many will be from that background. You understand the difference, right? Large circle, Venn diagram, small circle. You get the point. Anyway. Oh, interesting tangent, which is very interesting. This is in the notes. It's not a tangent off the top of my head. These tangents get me into a lot of trouble, especially for this topic. I have to be very precise what I say. Another very interesting tangent, which is relevant to us, and it is in my notes. One of the most famous claims of Jewish messianic fame was a person born and raised and died in Muslim land, spoke Arabic fluently. And he was a member of the Ottoman peoples, meaning a citizen, if you like, even though the concept of citizenship is modern. But and this is the famous rabbi known as Shabtai Tzvi. Shabtai Tzvi. Shabtai Tzvi was born in Ottoman lands in the 16th century. He died in, don't quote me, 17th century. And Shabtai Tzvi was a famous rabbi who began to have a larger and larger following and eventually claimed to be the Messiah. And his followers increased and he began demanding more and more things. A lot of problems happened. He's a very interesting figure. He intermingled with European kings and with the Sultan Mehmed IV, the famous Ottoman Sultan, until finally his demands became so ludicrous and political, and making a long story short, but he began to be political. And when he began to be political, the Sultan imprisoned him. And eventually his followers clamored and whatnot, so the Sultan decided to execute Shabtai Tzvi. And he called him to his palace, and he said, "Your penalty is death, but I shall forgive you if you convert to Islam." Now, I'm not arguing that was good or bad, I'm just telling you what happened. Whether that was good or not, it's not my business. That's what the Sultan Mehmed IV decided. If you convert to Islam, you are forgiven. Faced between these, Shabtai Tzvi decided to convert to Islam, which caused a great crisis amongst his followers. Because if he's the Messiah, what are you going to do now, right? It caused a huge crisis. He had thousands of followers, and they all thought that he's going to be the Messiah, bring the kingdom of David back, this and that. And lo and behold, he embraces the Shahada in public. He takes off the turban of the Yahud, and he wears a big Ottoman turban. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. In those days, your clothing would tell you apart. He had the clothing of a rabbi. And in the presence of the Sultan, he took off his rabbi cloak, and he wore the Ottoman, I'm not joking, it's not a joke, he wore the Ottoman turban, and he said the Shahada, and he said he's a Muslim. What are his followers going to do? Massive chaos, confusion. Some of them, I think the majority, ended up either saying this is a ruse or a tactic, or converting with him. A small group left him. So this turned out to be one of the most bizarre conversions in Islamic history, because what happened was his followers, in fact he himself, became half Jew, half Muslim. He observed Ramadan, but he observed the Sabbath as well. He read some Quran, but he also read the Hebrew. So he had this new thing that came about, and his followers were called Donme, which was a derogatory term by the Ottomans, by the Muslims of the time. Donme, there is no English equivalent. There's no English equivalent. It means convert, but not with a positive connotation, like a traitor convert. Like, there is no English word. A convert, but not like a positive convert. You've turned your back and left, and you've come, but we're not, like a big question mark, you know? That type. This is the term that who gave them? The Muslims of the time. They weren't happy with this guy and his followers. Too weird. Eventually, the Sultan, of course, by the way, initially was very happy, gave him a massive check here, massive money, you became a Muslim, good. Eventually, it turned out he's still observing Jewish rituals and customs, so he lost all favor, he was exiled, he died in exile. His followers, who are now outwardly Muslim, inwardly continued to be what are called crypto-Jews, okay? And their numbers increased, and they are still around in Turkey, the Donme. They're still around in Turkey. Now, to make the plot worse, to make the soup thick here, there's a lot of conspiracy theories. We Muslims love conspiracy theories. And the problem with conspiracy theories is they're so ludicrous except for the ones that are true. This is the problem. And you can't really tell the true from the falsehood until Allahu A'lam. So conspiracy theories are a problem. Nonetheless, I'm narrating the conspiracies, I'm not endorsing them, please, okay? So when Fox News comes and misquotes me those 10 seconds, please go back to this clip that I'm saying here right now, that I'm simply narrating so that you should be aware. I am not endorsing the conspiracy theories at all. The conspiracy theories that were started from that time frame, and they lasted up until today, they are there. The religious Muslims of the Ottoman lands said these people are zanadiqa. What are zanadiqa? Crypto-Muslims who want to destroy Islam. They're not real, they want to harm Islam. And they hate Islam, but they pretend to be Muslim. And the Donme became rich and powerful in a number of cities, in particular the one city where Shabtai Zvi died. And at the turn of the century, 100 years ago, and inshallah, in this year, I hope to give you a very academic lecture about the history of 1919, because that is one of the main turning points of our history, 1916 and 1919. In 2016, I gave a talk in my Memphis masjid, 1916 in the shaping of the Muslim world. Now it is 2019, and I want to give a part two to that. Inshallah, make dua, Allah gives me time and whatnot. It's just a matter of time and preparing the lecture and slides, but it's a 1919, you need to know this date. Around this time, 1919, around this time, a little bit before and after, but around this time, a group called the Young Turks were formed. And the Young Turks were a very, very secular, anti-religious groups of Turks who were keen on abolishing the Khilafah and bringing about a Turkey that was secular in nature. Now, what I'm about to tell you is true. Many of the leaders of this movement were from... In particular, a very, very dashing yet cruel, intellectual yet heartless man later called Mustafa Kemal, later called Ataturk. Ataturk is from the Donme, this is a fact. Now you go figure what is conspiracy and what is history. You go figure what is true and what is false. I'm simply telling you the perception about the motives of the Donme. And then I will tell you factually, Ataturk hated Islam. Ataturk mocked Islam. He was not a believer in Islam at all. And it's very clear that he considered Islam to be something that caused his people and nations to be backward. And if he wanted to, if he was able to, he would ban the religion. He did enough damage to the religion as it is. As you know, he shut down the madrasas, he abolished the Khilafah, he abolished the Grand Mufti, role of the Grand Mufti, he made the court system secular, got rid of all of the Sharia, he made the Quran to be recited in Turkish during the Salah. The Adhan was recited in Turkish, not in Arabic anymore. Instead of Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, they said something in Turkish. That was his whole point, to make everything Turk. So, Ataturk is from the Donme. You understand where conspiracy theories come from. And not just him, but many of those who followed him. Do you understand how this is relevant to Dajjal? It's not coming out of there. Shabtai Zvi claimed to be Masih. And all of this then leads there. Anyway, so we have 5-6 minutes left, so I needed to mention one final thing. Okay. Now, I have saved one issue to the very end because it is highly, highly, highly sensitive. And that is the a hadith that mentioned that towards the end of times, when the big Armageddon battle takes place, and there shall be Dajjal on one side and Isa on the other, that is the final Armageddon, the big one, that Isa will kill Dajjal. And then all of the followers of Dajjal will disperse, running for their lives. Many of them will be from that group. And they will try to save themselves by hiding. And the hadith mentions, this hadith is in Sahih Muslim, and there are versions of it in Bukhari, but it's Sahih Muslim primarily. The hadith mentions that at that time frame, the creation will side with the Muslims publicly. I shouldn't even just say Muslims, the supporters of Isa. Because there will be Christians who will support Isa and believe in him, so they will become Muslim, right? And for all we know, there might be Yahud as well, who will choose at that time to be with the truth. The hadith don't mention that all of them will follow. It just says the majority of his followers will be from there. There's a difference between the two. So, it was the hadith mentions that every tree and every rock will say to the believer, come, there is that person behind. Come, and he is hiding. So that there is no use to hide. There's no use to hide anymore, because the creation of Allah will publicly humiliate and say, oh, he's hiding here. Come and deal with this person. Except for the tree of Gharqad. That is a tree that will be quiet and not side with the Muslims. Now, every once in a while, some innocent khatib somewhere in the Western world gives a khutbah and he quotes this hadith. And memory jumps on him. You know what memory is. If you don't, then alhamdulillah for you. Or Fox News jumps on him. Or Pamela Geller jumps on him and takes this small clip and goes viral with it. And says, oh, this is an anti-Semite and he is calling for the destruction and he is Hitler version 2.73 and he is this and that. Bring him back again, right? So it becomes problematic to quote our own tradition because accusations of anti-Semitism come. And a few years ago, there was a University of California would host the MSA, uploaded all of the books of hadith. Once upon a time, if you ever did a Google about hadith, the first one would be the University of California, one of the MSA brothers. He uploaded all of the hadith collections, and it was a great resource. Obviously, these guys found it, and they found these ahadith in Sahih Muslim. And they said the university is anti-Semite, or it is hosting anti-Semites. It's hosting Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, right? So the university, it was a big scandal. The university had to get involved. The MSA had to edit and censor Sahih Muslim. Sahih Muslim had to cut a hadith if they wanted to host, and eventually the whole thing was pulled. There is no longer the hadith collection on that website. It's gone. It's gone. So this raises a very difficult topic. Are these a hadith anti-Semitic? The response, I think, is very clear. And that is that, first and foremost, as a matter of principle, these are traditions that are found in books authored 1,000 years ago, 1,200 years ago, you know, books of hadith. Censorship doesn't make any sense. Are you, O people who are criticizing a book in the past, going to censor your own books and not teach them when they have misogyny, when they have race issues, when they have issues that might be politically incorrect? There is hardly a classical book, hardly, except that there are phrases or notions. Even Shakespeare has anti-Semitism. Read The Merchant of Venice. It is a purely anti-Semitic tract. Are you going to ban The Merchant of Venice? Are you going to stop it and strip it from being sold? Are you going to take it and make it non-available? The hypocrisy is ludicrous. You don't go back and sanitize history just because you don't like it. Even if you don't like it, it needs to be taught and explained and clarified. That is a matter of principle. That is what liberalism stands on. And when it comes to every faith other than Islam, they uphold it. When it comes to Islam, we see the double standards. That's the first point. Second point, the accusations of anti-Semitism need to be addressed head on. They need to be addressed head on. And we need to stop being so defensive. Let us be frank and honest here. Study history, O Muslims. Be educated. Anti-Semitism is a European phenomenon. It's not a Muslim phenomenon. It never existed in Muslim lands up until 1947. Anti-Semitism is something that began in Europe by Christians, and it was prevalent throughout their history, and it is still around to this day. Muslims were never anti-Semitic. Yes, it is true. Sharia has Ahli Kitab and Muslim. But Ahli Kitab includes who? Christians and Jews. And there's a slightly different Sharia. It's not anti-Semitism. Historically speaking, Muslims and Jews historically had much more in common, and they would always bind together against the one who would persecute them, and that is the Afranj, the Rum, the Franks, the Christians. Historically, Muslims and Jews had a much stronger relationship than Muslims and Christians and Jews and Christians. Historically speaking, without exaggeration, the greatest minds of the Jewish tradition, pre-modernity, all of them are found in Muslim lands. All of them. Starting from Baghdad and ancient Iran and Andalus and Egypt, you have the greatest minds coming, including Shabtai Tzvi in Ottoman lands. They could not do what they did in Muslim lands. They could not do it in Europe. Every time the Christians persecuted the Jews, Muslims opened their doors. The last time, 1492, when the Muslims were expelled from Granada, the Sultan of the Ottoman land said, "You Europeans are fools. The Jews are intelligent people. They're useful. Why don't you come?" And he invited all of them en masse to come and live in Muslim lands. And that is why throughout the Muslim world, throughout the world, the largest population of Jews before 1947 were in Muslim lands. In Yemen, in Iraq, in Morocco, in Egypt. These were where the Jews were. So this whole notion of Muslims being anti-Semite by the very people who defended, by the very people who invented anti-Semitism. Please, Muslims, educate yourselves. Don't fall for all of this stuff, okay? Also, so that's historically speaking. Also, now let's get head on. Okay, so we talked about historically. Thirdly, let's get to the issue. Okay, well, the ahadith do mention killing. Let's be honest here. The ahadith do mention them. Jayyid, they do mention them. Let us realize these ahadith, they are predictions, not prescriptions. Big difference. They're predictions, not prescriptions. They're telling you what's going to happen. They're not telling you it is allowed to do it. So, if you believe in these predictions, you believe that stones are going to talk. I believe they're going to talk, but the people who criticize us don't. If you don't believe 90% of it, then why are you believing the 10%? These are predictions of the end of times, of Armageddon, what's going to happen, the apocalypse, the end of the world. If you believe that trees are going to talk, if you believe there's something called the Antichrist, if you believe there's something called the coming of Christ, well then, if you really believe that, fight on the side of truth, not the side of evil. End of story. If you don't believe it, these hadith are not telling Muslims to do anything. It's describing what's going to happen towards the end of times. And therefore, if you choose the side of good and not the side of evil, you're not going to have this issue. So the bottom line, we don't have to worry about this charge of anti-Semitism. We need to educate ourselves and challenge it head on. These are not anti-Semitic hadith whatsoever. It's merely describing a battle towards the end of times, the forces of good, the forces of evil. Those who choose the forces of evil will have to suffer the consequences. Simple as that. You don't believe in this battle, then don't quote 10 words and ignore the 100 word hadith. Don't quote that one phrase about the tree is going to say and ignore the whole context. That's being hypocritical. No scholar derives sharia from this. And again, to be brutally honest and blunt here, when the Holocaust was taking place in multiple places in the world, Muslims stood up to defend. Muslims stood up to help those that were being persecuted. This is a fact. The Muslims of France, the Muslims of Morocco, multiple places, they helped the Jewish people. And I have visited those places, Auschwitz and Dachau and others. And I will tell you honestly, and this is a reality that Allah knows, if I were alive at that time frame, I would have thought it is something that Allah will reward me if I were to protect these believers from that evil that was taking, believers in Allah overall, from that evil that is taking place. What happened afterwards, 1948 onwards, is not related to what happened before. If you were alive in 1940, you saw what is happening to this persecuted race, men, women, and children being killed indiscriminately, it would be a part of our iman to protect the innocent from this evil force of Nazi Hitlerism. That's something that I firmly believe, whether you agree or not, is besides the point. The point being, we need to challenge this notion of anti-Semitism. It is not anti-Semitic. These ahadith are predicting the future, not prescribing law right now.
Law tells us we protect minorities. That's what law tells us. Even in an ideal Islamic state, history proves that we protected those minorities. History proves that they flourished, the Yahud flourished under the lands of Islam like they did not flourish until the advent of modernity in Europe. They were not allowed to do what they were in Muslim lands. So we deny this accusation of anti-Semitism from its complete, as we said, number one, the issue of hypocrisy and double standards. Number two, historically speaking, where did anti-Semitism come from? Number three, the Muslims and the Jews and the relationship. Number four, these hadith are descriptions of the future, predictions, and not what? Prescriptions, not prescribing what is to be done. So there is no anti-Semitism whatsoever, and we Muslims cannot be anti-Semites because our Prophet ﷺ was a Semite, Ibrahim was a Semite, the majority of Semites are Muslims. How can Muslims be anti-Semites? Yes, we can be anti-Zionists, and we are anti-Zionists, but we are not people who hate Jews and Christians. No. There's a difference between Judaism and Zionism. Muslims, be careful. Never criticize Judaism en masse unless it's theology. We can criticize aspects of theology. Jews, there are good and bad people amongst them. Christians, good and bad. Zionism as a movement, you have Christian Zionists, as we explained. You have Jewish Zionists. You have atheist Zionists. And we criticize Zionists, but not people of other faith traditions. They're Ahli Kitab. With that, time is up. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue next Wednesday about the Nuzul of Isa and the issues of Isa, and then move on to the other major signs. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillah bil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.